Welcome, and thank you for finding your way here to our online worship service at Fairbanks First United Methodist Church. I'm Caroline. I'm the praise band leader here, and we just want you to know that we're happy you could join us today for the service. You're going to hear some scripture and prayers and praise music and traditional music, and it's all sung and spoken to God's glory. Thanks for being here, and enjoy the service.
Please join us in singing All the People Said Amen.
You are not alone if you are lonely when you feel afraid. You're not the only, we are all the same. In need of mercy to be forgiven and be free. It's all you've got to lean on, but thank God it's all you need. And all the people said amen. Oh, and all the people said amen. Give thanks to the Lord, for his love never ends. And all the people said amen. If you're rich or poor, well, it don't matter. Weak or strong, you know love is what we're after. We're all broken, but we're all in this together. God knows we stumble and fall. And he so loved the world, he sent his son to save us all. And all the people said amen. Whoa, and all the people said amen. Give thanks to the Lord, for his love never ends. And all the people said amen. Blessed are the poor in spirit who are torn apart. Blessed are the persecuted and the bitter in heart. Blessed are the people hungry where another starves. For this is the kingdom of God. And all the people said amen. Oh, and all the people said amen. Give thanks to the Lord, for his love never ends. And all the people said amen. And all the people said amen. Whoa, and all the people said amen. Give thanks to the Lord, for his love never ends. And all the people said amen. And all the people shout amen.
Welcome to First United Methodist Church in Fairbanks, Alaska. It's September 8th, 2024, the 16th Sunday after Pentecost. Jesus went away to try to escape notice, but it didn't work out so well. Although interrupted, he met with the needy and did everything well. This is the same vocation to which we are all called.
Sky. I have heard my people cry, all who dwell in dark and sin, my hand will save. I who made the stars of night, I will make their darkness bright. Who will bear my light?
Is it I, Lord? I
Together, let us join in the opening prayer. Lord, make our lives reflect what the gospel is about so that others around us might yearn for the transforming power of Jesus displayed in all we do, that we would step out of our comfort zone, firmly rooted in unshakable faith, to become radical for Jesus' sake. Amen. Listen now for a word from the Lord as I read from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 7, verses 24 through 37. From there he set out and went away to the region of Tyre. He entered a house and did not want anyone to know he was there, yet he could not escape notice. But a woman whose daughter had an unclean spirit immediately heard about him, and she came and bowed down at his feet. Now the woman was a Gentile of Syrophoenician origin. She begged him to cast out the demon out of her daughter. He said to her, "Let the children be fed first, for it's not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs." But she answered him, "Sir, even the dogs under the table eat the children's crumbs." Then he said to her, "For saying that, you may go. The demon has left your daughter." And when she went home, she found the child lying on the bed and the demon gone. Then he turned from the region of Tyre and went by way of Sidon toward the Sea of Galilee in the region of Decapolis. They brought to him a deaf man who had an impediment in his speech, and they begged him to lay his hand on him. He took him aside in private, away from the crowd, and put his finger into his ears and spat on it, touched his tongue. Then he looked up to heaven, he sighed, and said to him, "Ephphatha," that is, "be opened." And his ears were opened, and his tongue was released, and he spoke plainly. Then Jesus ordered them to tell no one. But the more he ordered them, the more zealously they proclaimed it. They were astounded beyond measure, saying, "He has done everything well. He even makes the deaf to hear and the mute to speak." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Once said something like this: we often think of Sabbath as simply not working. The reality is it's refraining from creating, which is what God did. This is revolutionary to many who've come to think of Sabbath as merely a day to catch up on everything you couldn't find the rest of the time to do, like chores, errands, crafts, projects, shopping. This has created a situation where many people find themselves at the end of their Sabbath time and do not feel rested, and do not feel that they've crossed everything off their to-do list that they were supposed to get done on the Sabbath. The teachings, however, of Sabbath have helped people to come to understand that nothing is expected of them on the Sabbath. Abraham Herschel once wrote in The Sabbath that the notion of rest is to refrain from constantly trying to change things around us, to stop trying to take dominion of our surroundings. This is combined from a view of resting from creating, resting from changing our external world. That is what Sabbath is. The attempt to get away could be as innocuous as trying to take a lunch break with your two friends, peace and quiet, and maybe you find a quiet bistro somewhere, and you sit down, and then here comes, well, Harold and Priscilla from the office. And the menu you've got is not big enough to hide behind. And they notice you and your friends, peace and quiet, vanish like echo or a dream. And they sit down and are delighted to chat with you during your quiet time. In today's gospel, we find Jesus is feeling maybe that same frustration. He too is unable to, quote unquote, escape notice. He goes to his vacation rental in Tyre on the coast of the Great Sea, and he entered the house and did not want anyone to know he was there, and alas, he does not escape notice. His reputation as a healer has preceded him. He is known as somebody who can help. The word on the street is when all else has failed, there's always that guy to go to. Yes, precisely this is what happens when the unnamed Gentile lady, known as the Syrophoenician woman, contacts Jesus. She has immediately heard about him, and I'm sure at this point others have as well. Her little girl, she tells Jesus, has an unclean spirit. And she didn't know that Jesus wanted a break, but she doesn't care. It says that she came, she bowed at his feet and begged him to cast the demon out of her daughter. And for some reason, the woman seems to wind him up. Jesus is first very harsh and talks about taking the children's food and giving it to the dogs. Yet she even says even the little puppies will eat the crumbs from the children's table. So, it simply says that he says that the demon has gone. We don't know how long it took from the moment he said that and when she got back and discovered her daughter sitting there with the demon gone. What we do know is that Jesus decides to leave his holiday. It's not working out. He leaves his holiday hideout and heads back to Galilee. The locals must have known he was coming, and they're waiting for him. This time, they bring him a deaf man who had an impediment in his speech, and they beg Jesus to heal him. You can also imagine Jesus sighing and saying, "All right," and touching the man's tongue and saying, "Be opened." And the nameless man was immediately healed. Now, Jesus pleaded, even ordered the crowds to keep quiet about this. But the more he ordered them, the more they talked about it. "He has done everything well," is what they said. Unwanted attention, unwanted publicity, unwelcome success, Jesus could not get away from it. He had a reputation for doing, quote unquote, everything well. Everywhere he went, even if he tried to sneak away, people found him and told every living soul about him. Jesus' reputation today? Somewhat different. He's done everything well. And there was the word then, but the news is now that a ton of people are repulsed by being what's done in his name. Yes, even by those that wave the Christian flag loud and proud. In fact, authors of continuous studies on religion and secularism that are done almost every year now, the number of people identifying as non-religious or identifying as the word none, N-O-N-E, is rapidly rising. The data shows that sometimes the story of Christians doing something stupid or offensive has pushed the undecided over the edge, slipping over immediately and creating new and new, more and more non-religious or none people who have no affiliation, who want no affiliation. It's really a surprise sometimes that the number of non-religious folks, non-faith-bearing folks, or at least people say that they're not believing, is growing. Yes, if the present trends continue, they will soon be the majority. But Jesus is not to blame. No, those that have been using his name are not the ones that are creating followers. They're actually pushing people away. His followers, Jesus' followers, sometimes are getting a bad rep. Yes, and it'll take work for people of faith who love Jesus to live and love by the higher standard he called us to. Yes, when Jesus slipped out of sight, he had hoped no one would notice. He might even feel that same way today because of so many people doing things in his name. Unlike the Syrophoenician women, people today do not bow down at his feet and beg, but instead they come to beg Jesus to endorse their cause or their movement or their issue. The Jesus who once said, "Follow me," people are now the ones going up to Jesus and saying, "Hey, Jesus, follow me." Christian political action committees, lobbyists both on the left and the right, committed to polishing Jesus' reputation in the halls of Congress to advance their own agendas. According to a study by the Pew Research Center's Forum on Religion and Public Life, advocacy organizations have grown from fewer than 40 in 1970 to more than 200 today. Together, they spend close to $400 million advocating for public policy, for various issues, from domestic and international issues, from bioethics, moral issues, economic issues, poverty concerns. Yes, some Christian groups are spending millions to argue positions that are opposed by other Christian groups who are also spending millions. I wonder how Jesus would feel if they showed up at his vacation cabana. If they did, it would probably get him to try to get him signed on with their cause. And then there's the so-called Christian groups who demonstrate against others, wanting to exclude them over who they love or where they were born, and wouldn't recognize Jesus if he wore a name tag. According to the Southern Poverty Law Center, a hate group is defined as a group that holds beliefs or practices that attack or malign an entire class of people, typically for their immutable characteristics. The Southern Poverty Law Center has identified more than 900 such groups operating in the United States. Some of them, believe it or not, are waving Bibles and using Jesus's name. And then there's those that are practicing kind of a sanctimonious Christianity, a better than everyone else, a holier than thou Christianity. Karl Rahner, noted theologian, once noted that the number one cause of atheism is not learning about science or evolution, no. It's not learning about philosophy or learning about other religions, no. The number one cause of atheism, simply put, is other Christians. Those who proclaim him with their mouths yet deny him with their actions. It's what an unbelieving world finds unbelievable. The good news is people are starting to see through it. People are starting to see through it and say, get out of my way. I would rather see Jesus. They've come to understand that sometimes Jesus and Christian are merely code words or brands that have nothing to do with Jesus himself, the historical Jesus that we encounter in the pages of Scripture, the one that we call risen Lord and Savior, the one we read about who comes from the first century Middle East. Yeah, the Middle East, and he spoke, didn't speak English, he spoke Aramaic and Hebrew and maybe Greek. The one who talked of a reign of God that was so different from the reality that we know from human experience that he had to speak in parables to help people understand. He is the Savior. And he doesn't share his throne and probably wouldn't want to share your T-shirt with whoever you might be voting for this year. Yes. Those are also people that need Jesus' healing touch as he provided in Tyre and Galilee, where he was able to expel a demon and help a deaf man to hear and to speak. If we're going to interfere with Jesus' vacation plans, the very least we might do is follow the Syrophoenician woman's model and ask Jesus to expel demons, to expel the demons of religious nationalism, of influence peddling, of sectarianism, of political and racial hatred, of provincial blindness and self-righteous arrogance. Expel these demons, O Lord. If we do this, the nuns of this world, those that have forsaken faith, might reconsider, as did the crowds in Galilee, saying he has done everything well. We don't have a word for the experience of traveling far to a far location for peace and quiet, only to have it ruined by someone who needs our time more. Yet even in this circumstance, Jesus' reputation was as being someone who did everything well. Even in those moments when he may have preferred to have peace and quiet, that needs to be our reputation. Let's remember to state the obvious. Right now, in this world, we are Jesus. Right now, it's us. Yes, the world needs Jesus, and the world needs those that are actually following Jesus, not just using his name. Let's be Jesus people who are willing to listen to the distraught mother, listen to the man who's out of work, or the teenager who's lost her way, willing to reach out to touch the lonely, the lost, the outcast, the leper. The public might not notice, so much the better. Even Jesus cautioned his friends to keep quiet, but they didn't. The yeast of kindness will leaven the dough of belief, and those close enough to witness it may come to say, yes, this Jesus has done everything well. Amen. We thank you for your continued support of our ministry here at the northernmost United Methodist Church that we know of. Let us pray. O Lord, we come giving more than we feel than we're able, even without counting the cost. Help us to give from the gratitude for all that we have been given. Melt our resistance. Help us to give as the widow who gave her mite, that she might know the joy of stepping out on faith. Help us also to move beyond our comfort zones with grateful hearts and with joy, because we are more than able through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Please join us in singing One Day.
the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Risen King, Jesus, shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
Let us take our joys and our concerns unto the Lord. Let us pray. Holy and gracious God, like the deaf man and the Syrophoenician daughter, we're all in need of healing. Some have sick bodies, some sick souls, minds, or spirits. We need a word or a touch from the great physician. For we are incapable of making ourselves well. We're powerless over the demons that beset us. Anger, worry, and fear grip at us. Depression, anxiety steal our joy. And disease robs us of vitality. Circumstances beyond our control plant seeds of doubt. Look upon us with mercy, O Lord. Look upon us with mercy and those in need of your healing touch. Come, O healing God, to our rescue with words of hope and reassurance that we might faithfully trust your healing and your guiding presence. It's in the name that we come with a prayer that Jesus taught his disciples, saying, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not unto temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. And now, wherever you are, whenever you're watching, go forth now. Let works proclaim faith. Let all that we do, our work, our rest, be to the glory of the one who has created us to bear the divine image. May all that we say, all that we do, point to you and be evidence of the hope that we have. Amen.
Please join us in singing, What a Friend.
Jesus, east to west, my sins are gone.
every horizon, and forever and ever His love is mine.